Alleluia! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia!
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I'll be read.
I do certify that at the 139th Annual Convention of the Diocese of Fond du Lac, held on October 19th, 2013 in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, the Reverend Matthew Allen Gunter was elected the 8th Bishop of the Diocese of Fond du Lac. The Reverend Gunter was elected on the second ballot with 43 votes in the clergy order and 73 votes in the lay order.
I do further certify that per Canon 3.11.3 sub A, that the diocese has evidence of the Reverend Gunter having been duly ordered deacon and priest, has copies of certificates from a licensed medical doctor and licensed psychiatrist attesting to his being fit to perform his duties as bishop, and has a testimonial to the election using the forms of Canon 3.11.3 sub A sub 3, signed by a majority of the convention, signed by all 168 delegates.
This is to certify that according to the Recorder of Ordinations, Matthew Allen Gunter was ordained to the diaconate on June 8, 1996 by Bishop David Schofield at St. James Episcopal Cathedral in Fresno, California, and to the priesthood on December 21, 1996 by Bishop Frank Griswold III for Bishop David Schofield at St. David's Church in Glenview, Illinois, signed by Felicia Diaz of the Church Pension Fund in his capacity as Recorder of Ordinations.
I hereby certify that consents have been received from the standing committees of 68 dioceses to the ordination and consecration of Matthew Allen Gunter to be the Bishop Diocesan of the Diocese of Fond du Lac.
Testimonial from the bishops pertaining to the ordination and consecration of the Bishop of Fond du Lac. Be it known by all the people of God that 90 bishops, being a majority of the bishops having jurisdiction in this church, have consented to the ordination and consecration of Matthew Allen Gunter as a bishop in the Church of God and to his status in the House of Bishops as Bishop of Fond du Lac, being the 1,081st bishop in the American succession. Signed, Kenneth L. Price, Jr., Secretary, House of Bishops.
My brother, please make your declaration.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I, Matthew Allen Gunter, chosen bishop of the church in Fond du Lac, solemnly declare that I do believe the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be the Word of God and to contain all things necessary to salvation. And I do solemnly engage to conform to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of the Episcopal Church.
Brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, you have heard testimony given that Matthew Allen Gunter has been duly and lawfully elected to be a bishop of the Church of God to serve in the Diocese of Fond du Lac. You have been assured of his suitability and that the Church has approved him for this sacred responsibility. Nevertheless, if any of you know any reason why we should not proceed, let it now be made known. Is it your will that we ordain Matthew a bishop?
That is our will.
Will you uphold Matthew as bishop?
We will.
The scriptures tell us that our Savior Christ spent the whole night in prayer before he chose and sent forth his 12 apostles. Likewise, the apostles prayed before they appointed Matthias to be one of their number. Let us, therefore, follow their examples and offer our prayers to Almighty God before we ordain Matthew for the work to which we trust the Holy Spirit has called him.
God the Father,
have mercy on us.
God the Son, God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy on us.
Holy Trinity, one God,
have mercy on us.
We pray to you, Lord Christ,
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love, and be found with fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all members of your church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve you in a true and godly life, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Catherine, our presiding bishop, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be filled with your love, may hunger for your truth, and may thirst after righteousness, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Matthew, chosen bishop in your church, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That he may fulfill the duties of this ministry, build up your church and glorify your name, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, he may be sustained and strengthened to persevere to the end, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For his family, that they may be adorned with all Christian virtues, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the mission of your church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in positions of public trust, especially Barack, our president, Scott, our governor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord. for a blessing upon all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord, our God.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Here is my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or uplift his voice, or make it heard in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth. And the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God, the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and I kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name, my glory I give to no other, no praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. of the Apostles. Now when the rulers and elders and scribes saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized they were uneducated and ordinary men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions of Jesus. When they saw the man who had been cured standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition, so they ordered them to leave the council while they discussed the matter with one another. They said, "What shall we do with them? For it is obvious to all who live in Jerusalem that a notable sign has been done through them. We cannot deny it. But to keep it from spreading further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name." So they called them and ordered them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered them, Whether it is right in God's sight to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge, for we cannot keep from speaking about what we have seen and heard." After threatening them again, they let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people, for all of them praised God for what had happened. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now after Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, from whom he had cast out seven demons. She went out and told those who had been with him while they were mourning and weeping. But when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they would not believe it. After this, he appeared in another form to two of them as they were walking into the country. And they went back and told the rest, but they did not believe them. Later, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were sitting at the table, and he upbraided them for their lack of faith and stubbornness, because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And he said to them, "Go into all the world and proclaim the good news to the whole creation." And they went out and proclaimed the good news everywhere, while the Lord worked with them and confirmed the message by the signs that accompanied it. The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. There is only one way to begin this sermon. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Bishop Catherine, bishops, fellow clergy, beloved of the Lord, visitors, parishioners, friends, family. It is wonderful for me to be able to be here with you this day. Matt, thank you for this invitation. So welcome, not least as it comes from someone I admire and have delighted in over the years, a ministry of such depth and integrity. It is also very good to be part of this historic diocese with its rich tradition, if only for a day, a tradition which I have loved, sometimes in exile. But this day of Matthew Gunther's consecration is an Easter week, and it shines with the light of resurrection, the triumph of God over sin and death and evil. God's eternal word and wisdom took flesh in Jesus. He taught and healed to announce God's reign finally come, God's day of infinite love and reconciling justice. That was a threat to the status quo, then and always. He was rejected and put to death, crystallizing humankind's long misrelation with a God who loves us. But God vindicated Jesus absolutely, raising him from the dead, revealing him as the center and principle and dynamic of a transformed humanity, indeed one day a transformed cosmos. Jesus himself alive is the good news the 11 apostles were sent to tell, together with Mary Magdalene and the couple walking in the country and hundreds of others and millions through history. And finally, all of us here today, together with soon-to-be Bishop Gunter. Easter week has to be just about the best possible occasion for the consecration of a new bishop, and perhaps especially for the Diocese of Fond du Lac, known throughout the church for its deep roots in the truth of the Incarnation, and not least for this man, himself so deeply and thoughtfully rooted in the faith of the church, and so empowered by his Lord, our risen Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit's power. This is a life-changing moment for him. For the diocese, long blessed with excellent bishops, it is the new gift of a new bishop with no new gospel, but fresh energy and vision. It is a call to every member of the church and every deacon and priest in the diocese to go about our mission with a renewed faith and vivid hope and passionate love of this joyful Eastertide. As is clear from the readings today, though, especially the epistle and the gospel, there are obstacles to doing so. Some of those obstacles are internal. To begin with, unbelief. The 11 did not believe the news that Jesus was alive when they were told it. People then and now may be skeptical about the truth of the resurrection while trying to find some way to stay part of the community even so, like the 11 huddled together when Jesus finally came to them alive. We may all be buzzing with questions that we cannot fully answer. Externally, we live in a culture around us that is a mix of things, depending in part on where we live, but in many places, increasingly, a culture of unbelief, just as the apostles were encountering then. Within that, there may be questions buzzing which are new to us and which we have heard poorly and have yet to hear clearly and answer in ways that can be understood. But the readings make it clear. When the apostles themselves will not believe, and later when they do but encounter the unbelief of those in power, Jesus himself is not frustrated. We will meet obstacles to the gospel in our own hearts and minds and in the world around us. But no part of this story is about the source of our power being ourselves, not even our faith. It is about God's faithfulness in Jesus Christ. Jesus is really alive. He comes to us in his sovereign freedom. Even to that first community that refused to believe the witness of the women, he came. In what mode or in what mood does he come? In today's gospel reading, he does upbraid the 11. But he doesn't come in fire and wrath. He doesn't even come in glory, not this time. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus' resurrected coming is gentle, his very identity sometimes veiled. No great apocalyptic scenes of God's vengeance on the unbelieving nations and on his own disciples' disobedience. No destroying angels, not even much in the way of the bright radiance of glory. No. He comes as Isaiah's mysterious, beautiful servant song tells us he comes. Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. The world-changing good news of Jesus' victory over sin and death and evil does not depend on conventional power as the world and often we understand it. Jesus, like the servant, comes gently, in love, not force, to reconcile, not destroy. It is in the power of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, that he comes. And Jesus shares that power with us, the power by which he is personally present with his people in their mission. We do not need, we have never needed the support of any kind of violence to carry out our mission. Even more, it is not our spiritual power, our faith or hope or love, that make the transforming difference. It is Jesus Christ in the power of the Spirit. God is faithful. God keeps his promises. God comes. God has done so in Jesus and comes now in the Spirit. This mission is God's initiative from start to finish, one day in God's glory when it does finish. It is in every sense our business to follow him, to take on this mission with all we are and all we have. But the mission is God's. But what is that mission? Here in today's gospel, that is not in doubt. Jesus tells his apostles, go into all the world and proclaim the good news to the whole creation. For 3 years, Matt Gunter read a version of these words painted over the altar in his seminary chapel, and I read the same ones for almost 30. It is these words that sent the apostles, and that send this man, the apostle's successor, and that send us all in mission on this very day of resurrection. This is the long-promised light to the nations, the opening of blind eyes, the freedom of prisoners of idolatry and meaninglessness. See, Isaiah says, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. This is the new thing, Jesus' victory. Jesus' victory means justice. It means making sinners just in God's eyes, accepted as God's own beloved, holy people, to be transfigured in Christ. It also means that Jesus is Lord and Caesar is not. Any human or transhuman power that glorifies itself as if it were God and uses its power not to build up but to tear down, to oppress and constrict and harm the people and the world God created, the power of any race or nation or government or social group or class or church, that power will not stand. Jesus comes gently, like the servant, but his coming is God's own, inevitable, like the tide coming in, like winter giving way to spring, like lights coming on in the darkness. Jesus brings justice. And let me note, this is good news to the whole creation. God is going to bring life not only to people everywhere, but to the whole of his creation, to all the world, to the seas that roar and the hills that clap their hands at his coming. In Christ, God means to renew and transfigure the world he created, to bring to an end what Paul calls its bondage to decay. That means that we, who are sent by Jesus on this mission, are called to bear witness as Christ heals and frees and cleanses and makes whole wherever it happens. We are message bearers, signs, instruments in the world through the church, through our daily lives and work. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Matthew Gunter, baptized Christian, husband and father, deacon and priest, and soon to be bishop. Very soon. You are yourself this day called, as you have been ever since the water went over you, to be a visible, audible sign of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. You are called to bear witness in word and deed and in the very shape of your life to the power of God's infinite life in the face of the power of death, of God's justice in the face of the power of sin and evil. Above all, you are now called to help his people, all of them, in partnership with them, to answer that call, to answer it with creativity, with wisdom old and new, with vision ancient and fresh. You are called to do that with the spirit of a servant, God's servant first, and the gospel's servant, in gentleness, and yet with great clarity, even when the apostolate means suffering, as it always has. For the true servant himself, Jesus Christ, goes before you and works with you. In Christ and through him in the Spirit, you must pray. Pray intently and as deeply as you can, no matter how intensely scheduled you are otherwise, and all of us here must pray with you. You must listen hard to these people, because they know things you cannot, and the Spirit may speak through them. Listen humbly. Listen hard to God's voice in Scripture and the deep tradition of the church. As for the voice of your beloved, as for the voice of truth incarnate, listen intently, discerningly to the world. Only so, out of deep discernment in the Spirit, can you speak openly and clearly, because then you will have something to say. Do not be overcome by the evil you encounter in the church and outside it, because Christ has overcome the power of evil. Do not become infallible. God says in Isaiah, "My glory I give to no other." Do not neglect the people who love you most dearly, and above all, your wife. This diocese is your second family, not your first. And you will need soul friends, and you will need books, and you will need the support of staff and volunteers, and indeed of every person in this diocese and far beyond it. But what you need most, you will have. And they went out and proclaimed the good news everywhere, while the Lord worked with them and confirmed the message by the signs that accompanied it. And those signs are all around you. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
My brother, the people have chosen you and have affirmed their trust in you by acclaiming your election. A bishop in God's holy church is called to be one with the apostles in proclaiming Christ's resurrection and interpreting the gospel, and to testify to Christ's sovereignty as Lord of lords and King of kings. You are called to guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the church, to celebrate and to provide for the administration of the sacraments of the new covenant, to ordain priests and deacons, and to join in ordaining bishops, and to be in all things a faithful pastor and wholesome example for the entire flock of Christ. With your fellow bishops, you will share in the leadership of the church throughout the world. Your heritage is the faith of patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and those of every generation who have looked to God in hope. Your joy will be to follow him who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Are you persuaded that God has called you to the office of bishop?
I am so persuaded.
Will you accept this call and fulfill this trust in obedience to Christ?
I will obey Christ and will serve in his name.
Will you be faithful in prayer and in the study of Holy Scripture that you may have the mind of Christ?
I will, for he is my help.
Will you boldly proclaim and interpret the gospel of Christ, enlightening the minds and stirring up the conscience of your people?
I will, in the power of the Spirit.
As a chief priest and pastor, will you encourage and support all baptized people in their gifts and ministries, nourish them from the riches of God's grace, pray for them without ceasing, and celebrate with them the sacraments of our redemption?
I will, in the name of Christ, the shepherd and bishop of our souls.
Will you guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the church?
I will, for the love of God.
Will you share with your fellow bishops in the government of the whole church? Will you sustain your fellow presbyters and take counsel with them? Will you guide and strengthen the deacons and all others who minister in the church?
I will, by the grace given me.
Will you be merciful to all, show compassion to the poor and strangers, and defend those who have no helper?
I will, for the sake of Christ Jesus.
Matthew, through these promises, you have committed yourself to God to serve his church in the office of bishop. We therefore call upon you, chosen to be a guardian of the church's faith, to lead us in confessing that faith.
We believe in one God.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Come, Holy Ghost, our souls inspire. Thou, the anointing Spirit art. Thy blessed unction from above. Enable with perpetual light. Anoint and cheer our soiled face. Keep far our foes, give peace at home. Teach us to know the Father, Son, that through the ages all along, praise to thy eternal merit.
God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, dwelling on high but having regard for the lowly, knowing all things before they come to pass, we give you thanks that from the beginning you have gathered and prepared a people to be heirs of the covenant of Abraham and have raised up prophets, kings, and priests, never leaving your temple untended. We praise you also that from the creation you have graciously accepted the ministry of those whom you have chosen. Therefore, Father, make Matthew a bishop in your church. Pour out upon him the power of your princely Spirit, whom you bestowed upon your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, with whom he endowed the apostles, and by whom your church is built up in every place, to the glory and unceasing praise of your name. To you, O Father, all hearts are open. Fill, we pray, the heart of this your servant, whom you have chosen to be a bishop in your church, with such love of you and of all the people, that he may feed and tend the flock of Christ, and exercise without reproach the high priesthood to which you have called him, serving before you day and night in the ministry of reconciliation, declaring pardon in your name, offering the holy gifts, and wisely overseeing the life and work of the church. In all things, may he present before you the acceptable offering of a pure and gentle and holy life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and power and glory in the church, now and forever.
Amen.
Faithful steward of his holy word and sacraments.
Amen.
Greet your new bishop and his family.
right? The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Share the peace of Christ.
Peace be with you, Jeff.
Thank you, Mike. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you, Steve.
Peace
be with you, Jerry.
Peace, Jesus. Peace, Sarah.
Peace be with you, Jay.
Peace, Hannah.
At an ordination, it is traditional that the offering go to the new bishop's discretionary fund. As my bishop in Oregon always said at ordinations, you will be very generous.
Thank you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God.
Alleluia. cherubim nor seraphim. Yadeho dolisas tiez olivoquase nor clodonio. Zaya Radogante, Zaya Radogante.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through the great Shepherd of your flock, Jesus Christ our Lord, who after his resurrection sent his apostles to preach the gospel and to teach all nations, and promised to be with them always, even to the end of the ages. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has
died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving.
recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. The bread of heaven.
Oh, grace, my God, so save the Lord, give the Lord.
Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us with the holy food of the body and blood of your Son, and for uniting us through him in the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up among us faithful servants for the ministry of your word and sacraments. We pray that Matthew may be to us an effective example in word and action, in love and patience, and in holiness of life. Grant that we with him may serve you now and always rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
The maker of heaven and earth.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
From this time forth forevermore.
And the blessing, mercy, and grace of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Let us go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia. Alleluia.